Thank you very much, David. That was a very kind welcome. So as David said, I am Zachary Peterson. I teach computer science and mostly computer security at Cal Poly San Luis Obispo. And for the last 5 years or so, I've been using game and play to teach computer security concepts to new and younger audiences that would typically have access to such content. And I'd like to share some of my experiences with you today. So like many schools right now, Cal Poly is now on the cyber train. And cynicism of that kind of mostly meaningless prefix aside, it's a genuine recognition and response to our nation's critical need for qualified computer security professionals. Year after year, we see reports not only on the current dearth, both in the public and private sector for these professionals, but an ever-increasing gap between the number of professionals we need and the number we expect to produce. Burning Glass reports that the cybersecurity job openings are growing 3 times faster than typical IT jobs, and this is in spite of a salary premium of 9% over those other IT jobs. The 2014 Computer Research Association Talby survey, which tracks university degree productions in computing, backs this up. So while overall CS degree production is on the rise, there's actually been a small decline in the number of PhDs in information security from the previous year, from about 5 to 4%. And what's more, who we're producing aren't very diverse, with a vast majority being white and Asian males. The College Board annual report on the computer science AP exam, probably our best measure of high school engagement and availability of computer science, tracks similarly, both in terms of interest and demographics. OK, so we're not producing enough. But does security need diversity? If we could produce more of the same, is our problem solved? And the answer is no. I think there's a real strong argument for diversity as an issue of equality and fairness, and I think this resonates with most. But even if we were trying to continue down the same path, white males are becoming a minority in this country, and by not including women and other underrepresented minorities, our problem is only going to get worse. And perhaps most importantly, and as William Wolfe stated, he's a former president of the National Academy of Engineering, that the quality of engineering is affected by diversity. So a diversity perspective means making new connections, seeing problems in different ways, removing the perceptual blindness that comes from monoculture. So yes, diversity is important, particularly in security. Okay. So given all this, why are our numbers so bad? Well, for one, CS is underrepresented in the CS curricula and curricular standards. For example, the ACM Computer Science Curricula 2013 guidelines recommends a minimum of 3 contact hours of information assurance and security throughout an entire CS undergraduate program. Okay, further, security is often relegated to a technical elective, seen only by a subset of self-selected students, typically in the computing majors, and at the end of a long prerequisite chain. Okay, this is truly a disservice. First, it unnecessarily constrains the student body to those who've already self-selected security and have already suffered the first-year attrition that's commonly seen in CS programs. Second, upper division students have already established habits, and not just programming habits, but the way that they approach problems and their computing behaviors. And so even if they were to try to change those behaviors, they've now limited their runway to practice these new behaviors before they're delivered to the workforce. And then third, and I think this audience would agree, security is no longer a specialization. It can't just be an elective. It's a core competency that every computing major and probably beyond needs to see. Okay, so what's the problem? Well, while security issues permeate nearly all aspects of our day-to-day lives, the technical complexities and mundane subtleties do not immediately lend themselves to lower division curricula. Exposing pre-college students to these same ideas kind of only further problematizes, or further problematized by these same issues. Okay, so more importantly, security can really problematize, make worse some of the same qualities we've seen in CS, that it's viewed as isolating and antisocial, or the domain of asocial males, that it lacks creativity, that it lacks social impact, or that it has any relevance to the real world. Okay, so I think that there's a way that we can change these things, and that's with cybersecurity games. Okay. So there's been a recent explosion in both the number and diversity of these games. CTF Time, which is a website that tracks these events, claims an average of 56 events per year since 2013. That's over one a week. Now, these events range from one-off asynchronous challenges to those that focus on particular skill sets, to those that are actually designed to train or even evaluate job candidates, to annual full simulation cyber war games, where the game mechanics, the time scale, and the technical skills necessary to play in them simulate the real world nearly perfectly. Okay, these games can be social, at least as our community defines social. Games have a real element of competition, which is naturally appealing to a community that historically values competition. So for example, in bragging rights and street cred. But are they pedagogically meaningful? Are they good tools for outreach, as some have claimed? Or are they simply equivalent to the upper division election electives, which are drawing these same self-selected populations? So can these games be more? Can they help fix what's wrong with computer security education? Well, it's no surprise, given that I'm up here, is I do believe games can be a really amazing tool for computer security education. And this is because games inspire players to challenge the limits of play by exploring with the meaning and interpretation of rules. Similarly, red teaming, right, where rule testing, rule interpretation, rule breaking are all prerequisite skills. Strategic thinking, identifying adversarial motivations, moves, counter moves, these are things that are all foundational to both games and security engineering. So said another way, many cybersecurity concepts are game concepts. So games are a natural vector for teaching the subject matter. So with this in mind, and with support from the National Science Foundation, Google, and Intel, I helped develop a new course at Cal Poly called CPE123, designed to engage first-year undergraduate students in CS and computer security principles through a set of thematically connected game-like coursework. The broad objective of the course was to attract undergraduates with no prior experience in computer science or security using authentic problems that demonstrated the relevance of security to the world around them, to highlight the role of computers in solving problems, and to challenge students to think adversarially and counterfactually, all while making an engaging and immersive experience. So, the first program many of the students will ever write is a password cracker, designed to break increasingly difficult levels of an online password manager. So through this assignment, first-year students now address security concepts head-on: authentication, hardness amplification, cryptography, the limits of computing. Also, this programming assignment encodes many of the elements that we strive to communicate in a traditional introduction to programming class: loops, conditionals, methods, right? It's all there. But here, the method is approachable, okay? It's contextual, it's engaging, it's scaffolded, okay? So this allows the students to engage in these ideas at their pace. Okay, so in addition to the exposure to core computer science ideas and security concepts, this approach naturally embeds many of the pedagogical methods identified as important to and effective in STEM learning. So these include reflective journaling as part of a team's progress log, near-peer instruction, and process-oriented guided inquiry learning, where the assumption of roles and independent exploration of a topic increase retention and understanding of the course content. So we've got kind of all the right elements. Are we actually making any effect? Are they learning anything? So we measured this. If I can advance the slide. There we go. So in our study, we used a methodology that consisted of a mixed method approach. We used pre- and post-course surveys. We analyzed those reflective journals. And we conducted student interviews at the end of the course. We were interested in assessing course grain metrics, things like, was the course fun? But we also wanted to measure students' attitudes towards security. Specifically, we wanted to ascertain the beliefs about their self-perceived abilities to be successful in computer security and how they perceived computer security as a discipline broadly. Overall, our results were really, really positive. So students described the exercise as fun, or wouldn't have been fun if taught another way, that the cloak and dagger themes really drew them into the content and helped them make connections to the real world. We measured both an increase in student engagement in security as a discipline, as well as their self-efficacy and their perception of success as a field. Okay, so at the end of the course, we asked students if their day-to-day security behaviors had changed, and many reported that they improved things like their physical security on their devices. They were more curious and cautious when visiting websites, including one of my freshmen who discovered a cross-site scripting vulnerability in a local eatery's website. They improved their password habits. Now, interestingly, we actually had a number of students who said they did not change their behaviors, but their cognition and reasoning behind that choice demonstrated thoughtfulness, analysis, and self-reflection. So for example, one of our students said that, I'm not going to change my relatively weak Netflix password, sorry, Brian. Then this is because like typing a better one on my mobile device, which is where I watch all my Netflix, is too onerous. Plus, that I think the risk associated with, or the harm associated with the compromise of this account is low, at least for him. All right, this is great. I mean, it's not ideal, but it's a good start. So by using games and play, we've been able to make some small progress in computer security education, at least at Cal Poly. Now, of course, this is a course for freshmen at Cal Poly who have already chosen to be computer science majors. We need to reach students at a much earlier age, and games can help here too. So there's been some recent work, including my own, in the use of tabletop games, board and card games, for both computer science education and computer security outreach. These types of games have some real unique advantages over their digital counterparts. So for one, these games can be accessible, with the potential to engage students with low computer confidence or low computer literacy. They are extremely social, being faithful to a player's expectation for what a social interaction looks like, so dispelling perhaps the perception of CS as purely isolating. They're unobtrusive. They require no technical support staff or expensive equipment. They can be deployed in a classroom or a club cheaply and easily. And they're modest. They make no pretense of representing reality, but at the same time, allow us to engage in kind of real, real security concepts, but in a much more approachable way. So my first game, Doxed, is a collaborative board game in which players assume the roles of white hat hackers and collaboratively tasked to retrieve a set of digital assets that have been held in an adversarial network. Now here, the game mechanics are strongly inspired by Matt Leacock's Forbidden Island. If you ever play that game, it's a great game. The intention of Docs is to create an artificial context for discussing real ideas in network security. There's been a real conscious effort here to introduce meaningful terminology in simplified but evocative mechanics that are consistent with real-world interpretations. So in our game, players compromise network infrastructure tiles. They discover zero-day cards to use and use them to keep those nodes compromised, all in the face of an adversarial network administrator that patches infrastructure and removes these compromised tiles for forensic investigation. So with support from the National Science Foundation to develop and evaluate Docs, I've been very fortunate to play with hundreds of students both across secondary and post-secondary education. We found that Docs has a real potential to start a dialogue with young audiences about the value of data, to demonstrate where the game deviates from reality, and to expose students to opportunities as computer security professionals, but in a very relaxed and playful setting. So beyond the instructor-led activities, Docs provides some real opportunities for informal learning, too. Here, both these students have claimed to have created the toughest game board possible, okay, by placing all the digital asset capture points at the very edge of the board and behind nodes that are more difficult to compromise, thus making the assets more difficult to acquire. I mean, this is great. This is a concrete example of adversarial thinking and, you know, pretty much exactly what a real network security engineer might do in the course of designing a real topology. Now here, students have combined two sets of the game to do I'm not sure what, okay, but they're pretty excited to do it. But what's great here is that Docs, like many games, allows the freedom to be creative, to adapt and to modify the rules and to develop new strategies, okay, all in a playful social setting. So the names of the assets are very generically named. Intellectual property, authentication credentials, PII, and financial data. Now this was intentional, and we leverage it as a teachable moment. As part of the core game, we provide blank digital asset mats, so the players can customize their digital assets that they seek out in the game, perhaps inspiring them to consider the value of their own real-life digital assets. Our experiences here, too, have been amazing. One of my students replaced intellectual property with grandma's secret fried chicken recipe, which had recently been transferred to the family's personal computer. Like, this is awesome, right? This is a contextual connection that she made about something that was very valuable to her and her family that probably couldn't happen in a less analog or less social way. So docs is free and open source. Anyone can create their own modifications, their translations, and download and print their own copies. Here we see a guy who downloaded it and then tweeted about it. A retail version, a retail quality version of the game is available from the Game Crafter, which is a print-on-demand game publisher, where we sell the game at its lowest allowable cost, basically just whatever the cost of the parts are. Now, I'm proud to say to date, we've actually sold over 1,200 copies of the game all across the globe. In addition, on the project's website, docs.com, we host a number of curriculum modules that provide guidance for teachers of all disciplines and of all student levels to lead follow-on discussions and activities around cybersecurity topics, so using docs as a catalyst. And we also include how these activities map to common core standards. So using docs as a data point here and extrapolating, there's evidence that there's some real opportunity for to use these games for outreach and start thinking about security at grades as low as, you know, third and fourth grade. The last project I'd like to share with you is a collection of kinesthetic security games that I'm starting to design using the same sort of informal approach to security education. We're currently playtesting these as part of a week-long security-themed summer camp that's held called EPIC, that's held annually at Cal Poly. Here, we see students attempting to fool the gate guard of an opposing team's castle into letting them in by making false claims about their origin, their destination, and what they're carrying. Sound familiar, right? So while here, we see a team trying to invent a gate access policy where it's required to accept more visitors than they have states to describe that policy. Now, with some recent funding from the NSF, we're going to be able to expand this curriculum and offer need-based scholarships to EPIC this year. Okay. So is our problem solved? Not quite. Okay? There are still many challenges associated with the use of games in security education. So for example, terminology. Our community really struggles when presenting existing games to established players, designing new games to reach new players, and interfacing with educators for the use of games in clubs and classrooms. It also further suggests some missing research on who players are and what they need from this community. And maybe most significantly, there's a real lack of common assessments and tools for measuring engagement. Currently, we have no way to comparatively measure what student populations are we reaching. Is their perception of security changing at all? Are they even being entertained? Or are we doubling down on the you must be this tall to ride mentality we've taken with security electives. So to this end, I've co-founded a new workshop with my colleague Mark Gondry to be co-located with USENIX Security this year called Advances in Security Education, or ACE. Now, ACE is dedicated to bringing together security educators, pedagogical researchers, and practitioners, particularly those that use games for education, to address some of these challenges and to help make a science from what is now an art. But what can you do? All right, start by promoting security education in your community. Bring a copy of Docs to your local high school CS club, or to a Girl Scout troop, or to an after-school program, and use it as an opportunity to share your experiences about computer security and this discipline. Don't have a club? Help make one. There's now tremendous resources online for helping seed age-appropriate activities for those clubs. Also, invent your own games and share them with us. Our umbrella project, Tabletop Security, now has a repository for them, so in a community space where you can share your games, you can play them, discuss them, and get them improved. But most importantly, show those around you that computer security can be fun, it can be relevant, and it can be inclusive. So, can games fix what's wrong with computer security education? I think so, but let's find out. It's our turn to play. Thank you.